Good morning again. My name is Michelle Corby, and I'm the Associate Director of Program Planning and Management at State's World Campus. It is my absolute pleasure to welcome you to COIL Fischer Speaker Series with Dr. Marni Baker Stein. Dr. Stein currently serves as the Chief Innovation Officer at the University of Texas Systems Institute for Transformational Learning. In this role, Dr. Stein is an authority on next generation program and curricular development, delivery and assessment, and student-centered, outcomes-focused instructional design with all the designers in the room. I'm sure we'll have a robust conversation. The mandate for the Institute is to leverage technology to make a University of Texas quality education more accessible, affordable, and successful, and the Institute's mission is to serve as a catalyst for innovation. Prior to joining the University of Texas team, she was the Senior Associate Dean Columbia University School of Communication. In this role, Dr. Stein oversaw the school's academic portfolio and was responsible for all online and hybrid programs. Dr. Stein frequently speaks on technology, enhanced curricular and pedagogical innovation. She's also an accomplished educational researcher. She holds a BS and MA from Penn State in French and English, respectively, from the College of Liberal Arts, and a PhD from Penn in teaching, learning, curriculum. And I actually had the pleasure of meeting and listening to Dr. Stein present to a small group at Penn State this past August. And I went back to my office and I was discussing the talk with my colleagues and I had a smile on my face. And they were like, what's that all about? And I said, you know, that was the most engaging and challenging and exciting conversation that I've had at work in a long time. So I'm absolutely thrilled to be able to continue that conversation today. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Marni Baker Stein back to Penn State.
No pressure. Well, thanks for having me. I'm really excited to be here today. My institute at the University of Texas System, the Institute for Transformational Learning, is situated, we report directly to the chancellor of the system, and our mission is to work on identify problems and pressing issues across the system and state in the space of higher education, work closely with campus partners across UT system campuses and health science centers to solve those problems. And so when I arrived at 2 years ago, one of the biggest problems that we were trying to solve for was at the undergraduate level in the area, in the UT system schools that were historically open access schools and that serve very diverse, complex student audiences, in many cases literally right on the border of Texas and Mexico. And so that was sort of one of our problem-solving contexts. And as we began to talk to presidents and provosts about, you know, what they were thinking about in terms of solutions, competency-based education came up again and again and again as a model that they were really interested in, but didn't really know much about. What was it, and how might this be applied, and, you know, could you help? So today I'll be talking about what happened after that, how our understanding of competency-based education has evolved, and since then, and our first prototypes. And so I hope this will be helpful for you. I'm not here to declare victory, absolutely not. It has been really, really hard, but also, what has emerged is an amazing opportunity for future models of education that we're all really excited about and positive about. So is this working? Okay. So there's been a great buzz about CBE, or competency-based education, for the last several years, although, as we all know, competency-based education or mastery-based education or performance-based education has been around for a long time across
many different disciplinary areas. There are many, many professional schools that have been very outcomes focused and accredited by reaching those outcomes for a long time, whether that's medical schools or business schools or law schools or nursing schools. So this is not a new idea. But since College for America, I think when it came to my mind is when College for America announced that they were going to do a competency-based program or at Southern New Hampshire University College for America. And I think it was probably like 2010-ish, they announced that this was in the works. I thought, what is this? Because at the time, I was doing the Middle States Outcomes mandate for the master's programs at the University of Pennsylvania, and I thought, wow, you know, I can't even get faculty to do a simple outcomes report for Middle States, and this is a college that's going to a completely competency-based degree platform. My stars, you know, how are they doing it? And
after that, you saw, okay,
so now it's Wisconsin Flex, or it's Capella, or it's Brandman, or Western Governors University came out right around that same time also. And the buzz started to grow, and then we saw Lumina get involved with the C-Band network and start having national conversations about implications of these new models. And so it's really been snowballing over the last couple of years, and to the point where I'm on the national advisory board for the Lumina Foundation for the C-Band network, and I these are not totally correct numbers, but the numbers of applications for substantive change to programs across the country from a traditional format to a CBE format has increased, it's remarkably over the last 2 years, from literally just a dozen or so each year to hundreds and hundreds of programs looking to go to this direction each year. So definitely something's happening. There's a lot of excitement. There are programs out there at both the graduate professional level and the undergraduate level. There are total competency-based degrees. There are competency-based, so you've got Brandman has their competency-based undergraduate degree, UW Flex has degrees, College for America has degrees, Western Governors University has degrees, among others, so there are whole competency-based degrees. There are competency-based trajectories, so Arizona State University has been working more on, let's take difficult trajectories like math and turn those into competency-based trajectories. There are competency-based certificates, so you see a lot of the big community college districts across the country going for certificates, whether it's project management or coding or whatever it is, very, very targeted certificates. So the programs are out there that run the gamut, and there really is a lot of growing positive feeling and interest, and that's great.
Good morning.
It's red. Okay. So there's also a lot of fear. I don't know how many of you saw the recent movie Inside Out. This is the character from that movie. So there's a lot of fear. A tremendous amount of fear.
Where are my glasses? Oh, thank goodness. They're right here.
Thank you. This is a list of seven things off the top of my head that I hear all the time from people that from faculty and administrators across the system that we're working with or that we might work with in the future. One of the top fears is that competency-based education is always totally online. I don't like that. That's not what we do. That's not our value proposition as a school or as a department. And so that's one of the fears. CBE model doesn't allow for face-to-face and hybrid delivery models. The second one I hear all the time is the model might be okay for adults with strong intrinsic or extrinsic motivation to engine their own studies, but not for traditional undergraduates, whatever that means. Because in Texas, that is... definitely a massive shift. What I would struggle to define a traditional undergraduate these days. The model does not allow for high-impact pedagogies like case-based, team-based, problem-based, competition-based learning. The focus is on exams, standardized assessments, and teaching to these tests. A lot of people really feel like competency-based education is a bunch of standardized tests that students are going to take, and that there's really no way to standardize some of the more high-impact pedagogies out there that we know are critical to learning. The fourth thing is the model may serve the development of certain technical skills or certain disciplinary areas of studies, but it's wholly unacceptable for others. And depending on who you talk to, it's like, well, they might be able to do this in computer science, but we can't do this in biology. Or I can see how chemistry can do it, but we can't do this in history, for example. And so that comes up all the time. The model waters down learning and allows for rampant cheating. The model eliminates the need for faculty. The model paves the way for unholy alliances between higher education and industry, cracking the foundations of higher education as we know it. And they get more radical from there. So I don't know if any of you who are designers or who work at World Campus has seen this list of answers before in your past. Have you seen this list? Where have you seen these lists? I'm sorry, I'm asking for somebody to say something. Do I need to take the microphone to them? Somebody else? Okay, so where have you seen this list before? Anybody in the past year? Exactly. It's like Groundhog's Day. It's like I woke up again in like 2004, 2005, and it's just the exact list that I was hearing then for online. It's almost word for word. It's the same set of fears in play again. So, and those fears, I think, are legitimate because when we're thinking about competency-based education or talking about it, just as we did this morning, it's as if we are all talking about the same thing, but we're not. What the heck is it? What is competency-based education anyway, right? It's until we have a common definition, which we probably don't want, of course it's going to be scary because the minute it comes out of our mouth, it conjures up images in people's minds that are, in some cases, insurmountable. So there are lots of definitions out there for competency-based education on the web, and I was going through them last night once again, and most of them are super convoluted. So I picked this one out because it was the simplest one I found. And look, I didn't even cite it. It was from an educational organization related to the Department of Education. So competency-based learning refers to systems of instruction, assessment, grading, and academic reporting that are based on students demonstrating what they've learned, that they've learned the knowledge and skills they're expected to learn as they progress through their education. Stop. Full stop. That's all competency-based education is. It could be personalized. There may be adaptive components. It may allow the students to go faster or slower. It may include technology. It may have online components. It may be working toward a degree. There might also be a course-based transcript. Right? It's many, many different things. It could end up being 100 different things, but at its heart, really, this is what it is. That the shift is really from a focus on the credit hour, where time is constant, where learning is variable. So we know that I'm in a 15-week general chemistry course. I'm going to pick on general chemistry because I always do it, so I'm obsessed. So I'm in a 15-week general chemistry course. I take the first midterm, the second midterm, and the final, and I'm done. And where I am at the end of that, whether I have a C or a D or a B or year in A is represented by the time that I spent in those 15 weeks and the scores that I've received on those tests, which may or may not be indicative of what I understand, what I know, and what my skills are. That's the current system. And at the end of that course, if I've gotten a D or an F, I can either take it again or decide chemistry is not for me, or out of school, or whatever I'm supposed to do. In competency based, the focus is on learning, where time is variable, but learning is constant. So let's think about general chemistry again. We have a general chemistry project at PTRUD. So in this case, there's still a set of assessments. And those assessments have been designed to test, you know, what I know and am able to do and sort of my attitudes towards work chemistry. And as you noted earlier, the construction and delivery of those assessments is critical to the validity and reliability to this model. But because it's a competency-based system, when I get to that first midterm, I may get to it on October 15th. You may get to it on November 15th. You may get to it on December 15th. Depending on my readiness to take that assessment. And when I take that assessment, if I don't do well, I may be able to take it again. And so it may take me not 15 weeks to get through general chemistry, it may take me 30 weeks to get through general chemistry, or it may take me 7 if I had a really strong chemistry experience when I was in high school. So that's kind of the difference between the two models, but how that second model is executed varies widely from CBE and wildly from CBE program to CBE program. So, knowing all of this variability that's out there in the field in Texas, we think about CBE as a framework for thinking about and designing new models of education that will help us solve for some of our most troubling, pervasive, and persistent problems. So we are not interested in CBE for CBE's sake. We have some food problems that we think CBE may provide a solution for those problems. And we will not invest a single dime of money or effort in anything that we don't think is going to be solving for a specific problem that we can then measure the impact of that solution over time. So our mission, as I said before, is to develop transformational, cross-institutional models of education that are student-centered, industry-aligned, personalized, data-driven, and scalable. And these new models will make students dramatically more successful as learners, working professionals, and leaders in their fields. Across the UT system, we have slightly under half of the students who start college finish. And with certain student populations, and in certain disciplinary areas, the numbers are much worse than that. This is a state that is growing rapidly across many industry sectors that take a really advanced knowledge workforce in the STEM areas in particular. And so this is a legitimate problem that we need to solve for in the state of Texas, but I would argue all of us need to solve for this problem. It's pretty much the same everywhere. Our aim is to break through the iron triangle of access, affordability, and quality with our initiatives. And we aim to do that through the intersection of high fidelity program and instructional design and production, high impact student life cycle services, and next generation technologies. So to say that we do not think when we go and work on an initiative, we understand that any change like starting a new CBE trajectory is a transformational systemic change. And you have to design not just for the curriculum, but also for the supporting services. And in many cases, you have to redesign all of the technical systems that support that experience to make that experience go. So, we do our work through a collaborative approach, meaning that when we work on these projects, we not only work with the schools and the universities and the schools, colleges, and departments and the faculty, but We also work across schools in the system. I don't know how many of you know much about UT system. There are we have almost 250,000 students enrolled across the system, across seven academic campuses, and then we have several health science centers. And so it is a very large system. It is a very complex system. We have universities all over the state. And I don't know how many of you have been to Texas? Oh, okay, good. So you know how big that state is. It's sometimes 10 hours driving time between one or more, between one campus and another campus. And so it's a big, complex thing. But what we're trying to do is create a community of practice and learning.
Early innovators at each of our campus sites to solve for these problems. So it's a very collaborative approach. We have gone out campus and basically said, you know, what's the problem that you think CBE can help you solve? And we have come up with many, many different pilot tests or experimental sites. So we're working in the area of the undergraduate health professions with UT Rio Grande Valley, which is down in the tippy tip of Texas, and with UT Arlington, which is right outside of Dallas. These are both undergraduate programs. In the case of UTRGV, BS in Biomedical Sciences, this is a program that's the problem is in South Texas. Is South Texas has a fast-growing population. It is right on the border, and there are a lot of public health and health problems in that area. But yet, that area is not producing its own health professions to work on those problems in that area. So they have a real skills gap and employment gap, and they're having to bring people in from the outside to come down there, and that's hard. So the problem that we're trying to solve is how can we build the funnel of qualified, inspired students who want to go into the health professions, whether they want to be a doctor, a nurse, a PA, public health researcher. How can we increase that funnel and increase that number to serve the need, the workforce need, essentially, in that area? So that is a program that is face-to-face. It is a flipped classroom model, and it is serving students coming right out of high school. UT Arlington's BS in nursing. UT Arlington's issue is they already have a giant nursing RN to BSN program, but for their BSN program, they have to turn away thousands and thousands of applicants every year because they just don't have the capacity to serve them. And yet Texas has a real workforce gap in nursing. So how can we solve for that problem? And another aspect of their problem is that there are a lot of military folk, veterans coming in from of the branches of the military who are coming in with significant certification as medics, et cetera. How can we take those certifications and clinical experiences and build them in through prior learning assessment into these nursing trajectories in ways that get more of them through to these jobs that are out there waiting for them? So as you can see, just as an example, the UT Arlington is more adult student, working professionals, many of them returning from military service. UTRGV is really focused on that more traditional undergraduate market. UT Arlington will be a primarily online or low residency hybrid program. UTRGV is a face-to-face program with flipped classroom, differentiated classroom approach. So just to show you how different they can be in terms of target population and problem that we're trying to solve, and each of those contexts is going to radically impact the model of CBE that we can actually come up with and will come up with. Those of you thinking in a business-minded way, which I appreciate because all of our programs have the mission to be sustainable and stand on their own feet over time. The other thing that I can say about the UTRGV and UT Arlington model is there is pent up unmet demand for these programs so that we can launch them and we really won't have to spend a dime of marketing money to get them to go. I mean, we obviously will market them. We'll want to get the word out about them, but we didn't want that to be our problem. We didn't want a if we build it, then we'll come scenario, but we wanted to take a scenario where we know there's all this demand from students and from employers and build from there. So each of our areas that we're working with has a similar story. I won't bore you with the rest, but we are doing lots of different types of projects. Some of them are degrees, some of them are certificates, and some of them are trajectories. So at UT Dallas, for example, we had originally started out thinking, we're going to work on a CBE degree in computer science. And we started talking more and more with the UT Dallas folks, and they're like, you know, this just isn't right. We're trying to establish our brand in this area. We already have tons of students coming into our computer science program on campus. This isn't our problem. We're not solving a problem with this. And so we sort of sat down at the table again and again, and we said, okay, then what is the problem we really want to solve for here? And we narrowed in on that problem, and their problem really is they've got students coming in from high school with varying numbers of dual credit and AP credit, and then they're coming in and having to get their general core complete so that they can take on some of these very interesting certificates and upper division courses and majors in computer science, et cetera. They're very interested in creating an accelerated general core for these students that has some elements of competency-based approach. But maybe based on the conversation we had earlier, you all weren't thinking of that approach when you were thinking of CBE. But we think of it as CBE, as it has a competency-based element. So we're doing programs across all of these schools. They are considered experimental sites by the system. And that means that in order to create a community of learning and a collaborative community of practice amongst all these projects, that we have taken each program through the same market research approach. All programs have our exact same program and instructional design methodology applied to them. So there are no major differences between programs and how we approach program and instructional design. They are all offered on the same technical platform, which I'll talk about in a minute why that is really important as well. But the reason it was really important to us is the analytics infrastructure that's under the technology that we're offering allows us to test out these programs at scale, understand what's going on, and make these programs better and better as time goes by. We are also working on the graduate and professional certificate front. So we are working across three different medical schools on a personalized competency-based approach for the first M1 and M2, the first 2 years of medical school, which is, I don't know if any of you have any experience with medical school, but one of the biggest challenges they have in the first 2 years is they've got students coming in who were organic chemistry majors, et cetera, who could really buzz through much of the basic sciences knowledge that's presented in those modules or those courses. And then they've got other really great students who were theater majors or who were in the liberal arts who are coming in who have more of a learning curve. But yet it's 2 years, and then at the end of 2 years, you take USMLE and you start going this step and then you go on. So that was a problem they were solving for. We have this incredible wide spectrum of learners, all highly academically qualified, who are coming in, and there's this assumption that they're all going to take the same time. And what they're finding is that those students who are having too easy of a time, who are the organic chemistry majors, are just not coming to class, and they're studying for the USMLE for those 2 years, literally 2 years of studying for the USMLE. And those students who are coming with some sort of deficit, though still highly academically qualified, are having to make up lost time. And so faculty in those missions or modules or courses or whatever they're calling them have to shoot down the middle of that death spiral, making time together less than efficient and less than powerful. That's the problem we're solving for there. We're also doing graduate health certificates. and continuing education modules and certificates. But again, the design, the approach to design, the methodology for program design and instructional design, and the technology we're using is shared. And our idea is that those methodologies for program design and instructional design, they are the most important intellectual property of all that's coming out of here. These projects, single projects in a gigantic system, they're going to do well. I'm sure they're going to be great. But that's not what's important to us. The important thing to us is, can we get to sort of replicable, scalable methodologies for doing this? And can we study those methodologies and make them better and better? Same with the technology. You know, can we use the these experimental sites and these prototypes to test out our hypotheses about different types of technical environments to serve this type of education and make those better and better and better over time with everything that we're learning? So all of these use cases, all these prototypes, are driving epic transformational change on every level of the program experience. And I cannot stress this enough, because for us, when we put out the call for experimental sites, we got lots of departments and colleges and faculty at these different institutions for different reasons got back to us with ideas. We have an embarrassment of programming ideas on this front. Whether or not those people knew what they were getting into, that's another story. But there was will there, unmet sort of demand for this across the colleges. So that's not our problem. Our problem begins when we start working on these ideas, A, when the rubber hits the road with the design process, and we need to start questioning our assumptions, assessment, and time, and coverage, and coverage, and coverage, and all these different beliefs, deeply held beliefs, and mindsets on the faculty side. There's change management there that has to happen. And that takes a long time. And we're getting better and better at working on that. So that's part of it. But I feel like even that is not the hardest hurdle we've had to cross. The hardest hurdle we've had to cross, oh, you can't see any of those words, is that when you have a program like this, so let's say then UTRGV BS in biomedical sciences, we decide with that program that even though there's a term-based aspect to it and there's a transcript for those students, a course-based transcript, which there has to be, because they will never get into medical school or graduate school if they don't have that transcript. You know, if we're allowing for the personalization of pace, really allowing for that, that's going to mess up everything across multiple systems that support that program. Okay, faculty workload is messed up. Term becomes a really nasty impediment to doing this, because if you don't finish by the end of the term, then you don't have satisfactory progress toward sort of your financial aid marks or et cetera. And then we have to issue some kind of a grade at the end of term, like an incomplete or withdrawal or something. And then that has an impact on your transcript. And we don't want that. We don't want negative marks on a student's transcript because of what we're trying to do. So all of those issues have to be worked out with the registrar and financial aid and the academic advising office, because the academic advising office is advising 30,000 students. And here comes this experimental site that has a whole different set of rules. They have to be with you, because students are going to find their way to that academic advising office, and they're going to need to get the right answers, right? So it has these changes, you're dropping a stone in a pool, and it has a ripple effect. It has a systemic effect. And everybody has to be with you, because we all know if they're not with you, they're against you, right? And so it is a cross-system team effort to make sure that these work. And a lot of the innovation that has to happen to make these programs run is not curricular or is not the classroom experience. Not that there's not innovation there. There's a ton of it. But it's these other administrative services and academic operations and IT who also need to be willing to play and see themselves as innovators and problem solvers in their own right. And not to pick on anybody, because we saw this behavior across all functions, whether it's faculty, academic ops, student services, et cetera, these people have their gig down, right? They've been working with a bag of tricks for years, and they have their checklist that they check off, and they're checkers, right? And turning checkers into solvers, when those checkers in many cases have been at it and behave, that's been their life, that's been their way of being and doing for years, sometimes decades, that's hard. That's hard. Everybody has to get out of their comfort space. So it really is important, not only you identify the problem and you identify CB as a solution, and you get to the right prototypes or use cases to test out that solution, but from the very beginning, you have to understand that it's going to have a systemic impact that has to be planned for. And there has to be real institutional will behind this, or you could very well be planting a delightful seed in the swamp. And it gets eaten alive by things you didn't even think it might. So when we first started doing this, working on our first project, and our first project was at UTRGV, anybody recognize this photo? No? This is South Padre Island, right off of the tippy-tippy tip of Texas. A lot of people don't think of Texas as having a coastline. I know I didn't before I went there. But this is a beautiful island, right? It's about 15 kilometers or so away from the school where we're working. So I put this island up here because we decided very early on that if we were going to do these experimental sites, we would have to take an island approach. And if you look at some of the big CBE players that are out there, they have all done this. Even Southern New Hampshire University, who has a massive online university, could not build CBE programs inside of their framework. You know, they already have modularized programs. They already have accelerated programs. They couldn't do CBE inside of their traditional framework. And that is precisely because CBE requires systemic change. And in the case of Southern New Hampshire or Capella or Brandman or UW Flex, the biggest change of all is the underlying technologies that support all the services. So it's almost impossible to build this system inside I won't pick on any system inside of a traditional student information system, which could be PeopleSoft or Banner, et cetera. Those systems, whether it is the SIS systems or the CRM systems, I don't know if you use Hobson's or anything like that, or the LMS systems, whether it's Blackboard or Canvas or Moodle or whatever you use, they're all based on the assumption of a term-based, course-based system. And you can blow them up, but it is really clunky to do that. And when you think of them as a stack, it is just really, really troublesome to try to get to termless, modularized learning experiences that may or may not have courses as we know them, and that support both a course-based and a competency-based transcript. Imagine going to your, I don't know what you do, but imagine me going to my PeopleSoft administrator and saying, this is what I want to do. Is this going to be a problem? Of course it is. So we knew that like Southern New Hampshire University and like Brandman, Capella, EDMC, which has University of South Art Institute, these are the early innovators in this space. They all built their own stack for competency-based education. It, of course, ultimately had to integrate with their SIS, what system of record was. But those integration points were minimized so that they could really innovate with the technology and the services for this particular model. So our first program I'm just going to talk a little bit about was our BS in Biomedical Sciences at UTRGV. These are some of the students and faculty in that program. The program is really aims to, it has multiple tracks. So when you come into the program, many of the students are aiming for medical school, but you might also go into biomedical informatics, or you may go into a PA program, or you may go into a public health track, et cetera. So it really is a really neat program, and there are lots of field service and clinical aspects to the program that are community driven and very powerful. It's a very powerful asset to the whole region. The UTRGV BS, and I really want to talk about this one in particular because I think this program really strikes a lot of those fears and preconceptions about what CBE is, because it's kind of the opposite of all of those things. And so I just want to talk about this as an example, but it's not the example. It's one example that sort of tests some of the boundaries. So the first thing when you're developing, the first big challenge when you're developing a CBE curriculum is, what is the definition of a competency in the disciplinary area that you're working in? Because that varies, again, wildly from discipline to discipline. And if you look at all these different programs that are out there, Western Governors, Brandman, they all have a different definition of competency. In some cases, all they have done is taken 120 credit hours of 3-credit courses, broken each of those 3-credit courses into a single credit, and called each single credit a competency and associated it with an outcome. So really, it's a nomenclature change in those cases. And that's very, very common. You look at some of these programs that have 140 competencies or 240 competencies, it's likely that that's what they've done. And then you have other programs that are more of a competency scaffold. So our programs that we're working on, our programs all spawn out of like nursing, biomedical sciences, first use cases. So we took a very different approach. We took a scaffold approach where we defined high-level competencies that students will work over time across an entire degree or maybe even across an entire career. And we break those into enabling objectives or subcompetencies, and those enabling objectives are then broken up into levels, almost like karate levels, like from white belt to black belt and beyond across time. So you're working on these competencies in a spiral fashion again and again and again, getting better and better and better at what you're doing. And the advantage of this, we feel, is that it strikes an arrow through the heart of the forgetting curve problem, which is students see something once their freshman year and don't see it again till their junior year or whenever. So that's what we did. This is just a list of the high-level competencies. These are all tagged to the medical school competencies, which are tagged to MCAT, USMLE, ACGME, Institute of Medicine, et cetera. So we worked really closely with some of these agencies to make sure that all the competency scaffolds that we were defining were, we could, once students leave us, we could assess performance on those competencies in external exams or in performance contexts like their residency, et cetera. Because what we want to do is we don't want to just see how well are they doing on our assessment trajectories. We want to see how well are they then doing on the MCAT, how well are they doing in their residencies, and how well are they doing beyond. Right? That's what we feel competencies are. We don't want it just to be another fancy word for credit hour. Which isn't to say we're right. Right, because there are lots of scaffolds. The military has scaffolds for competencies, which they don't call competencies, but they have these basically micro skill sets that stack up into levels. And those levels stack up to higher levels and higher levels. You could do it however you want to do it. That's kind of the beauty of the moment we're in. But it also causes a lot of the confusion out there when we're talking about competency-based education. What is it? And maybe it isn't always the same thing, depending on what the disciplinary area is. We're seeing massive differences, for example, between what cybersecurity believes is competency based on their external standards and what nursing sees as competency based on their external standards. So then the next great joy of this journey is once you have that competency scaffold, if you want to develop rich, valid, reliable learning trajectories that are tied to, and assessments that are tied to that, you have to do an extensive amount of knowledge mapping, graphing, and assessment trajectory development. And that all has to be as good as you can get it before you get it out to students and then validate it over time. And that's really hard and expensive if you do it right. And it's a new skill set for many of us designers who have not been out there doing knowledge graphing as a matter of course. Once you have the competencies and the knowledge graph, then you need to think about how does this translate into experiences for students, assessment or experiences of learning. And so you have to come up with a theory about this. This is one theory that we have in place where it's a spiral control guided free, where they start with checks for understanding that gate them into performance-based assessments that gate them into team-based learning frameworks. And the team-based learning frameworks are collaborative in the field activities they do around clinical settings. But this could be anything. Again, this works for this particular thing. And this, all of these assessments have to be tied to that map, which has to be tied to that competency scaffold and measurable over time. So, and then there have to be theories about pace, right? So is this a total open-paced program? Do students need to, are you going to say, okay, we're going to give you more time, but we're only going to give you this much time? And as students are moving through and you can see their progress, what are the thoughts that you want to put up to those students or to their service team to let them know what's happening? What are the interventions that are going to come as a result of those flags? So these are some of our students in our first program that launched at the beginning of this term. We actually, as we were controlling the technology environment, we decided to make this an iPad program first out. That was easier for us because we wanted to design a mobile first, offline first environment, and it was easier to develop it for one environment than all of them in our first round. So students receiving their iPads, only two of 146 students had ever used an iPad before, just to give you a sense of where we were in the world. Many of these students live 60 miles from school. Many of these students do not have any kind of connectivity in their home environment and have to travel out of that environment to get to a signal. In our system that we built, one of the most important things for us is we need to be able to have and value a course-based transcript, but we also needed to have and hold and value a competency-based transcript. So as students move through their experience, not only is that leading to ultimately a grade in the course, but it's leading to these competencies over time. So with this student, you can see they're working on several enabling objectives at levels 1, 2, and 3, and everything they do, basically, there's an algorithm that has this little green thing progressing. And so when the green comes right around, it's like, ding, you're a level 2. And then it comes around, ding, you're a level 3. And once you get to level 3 all across these, that competency badge twirls, and then you would be able to share it with your LinkedIn group or whatever you want to do. It's a badging certification. Another thing we had to work really hard on was the gated traverse. So like I'm working along, but we want to make sure that I'm qualified to go into the performance assessment activities and I'm qualified to go into the team-based learning, and that's indicated to me. We wanted students to have a sense of that progress and to celebrate that progress. So in the iPad app, that would be my picture up there. And as I'm working down through these units, my picture would be coming down this slide, and I could actually see how close I was to finishing. At the end of each of the units, if you click into here, as I work through each of the activity slowly fills up and checks, and at the end, there's a celebratory moment that's like, ding, you finish this unit and you're on to the next. So we're playing around a lot with these kinds of things. We had to be able to support a wide range of assessments, and this is one of our big weak spots to date. We had to support ultimately assessments of everything from fine motor skills to the NCLEX, to team-based learning activities, to collaborative case activities. How many of you know of a single LMS that can do all of that differently? Right. And so it's an issue. We started out with Canvas. Canvas was an initial partner for our assessment engine. Nothing against Canvas. They're great for lots of different contexts. This context is not going to be, we cannot expect Canvas to handle it. Just cannot. And this, and as beautiful as we can make this environment, when they get into Canvas, it's still multiple choice, open-ended answers, et cetera, et cetera. We need a much more robust ecosystem of assessments. We had to have both offline and bilingual content that we worked with in this case, because students needed to be able to download all of the content so when they go home, they can see it offline and work on it offline. Also, about 20% of the students in this program prefer Spanish as their language of instruction, and so we needed to make that available as well. There need to be all kinds of creative hooks, so we don't want this to we are also innovating in the space of high fidelity content and experience. We don't want this to be a flat online homework experience. We want to be experimenting with simulations and interactives and transmedia and gamification, because engagement is really, really critical hooks to keep those students coming back and keep on track. The whole experience is based around, first year experience in composition, chemistry, and biomedicine is based around a common story and integrating red thread, which are these clinical rounds around 17 diseases and conditions that they will meet on the MCAT eventually if they take the MCAT. And so when they're in comp class, they're writing about these diseases and conditions. When they're in chemistry, their labs are clinically focused and have this lens to an extent. And in biomedicine, the whole biomedicine is built around it. So when students are going into these different classes, they're hooked together by this virtual clinical experience. And we really hope that this was going to give them windows. Again, hooks. Keep going. You're not in chemistry for no reason. We're not just foisting this upon you. So that's what we did. 8 weeks into the program, we see that a large percentage of the students are actually keeping the most accelerated pace. That was a surprise to us. We thought we would see great variability in student slowdown. But what we see has happened, 8 weeks in, no victory declared, probably won't continue, is that the gamification of the system and the sort of inherent competition between getting these activities done seems to be motivating them to do the work. There are student complaints that it's too much work. If they could just go to the other class where they could put off the work and cram the night before the midterm, they could go to the same parties that their friends go to. And that has definitely come up. And what's interesting is that it is some of the better prepared students who are saying that. So it's the students who are academically well prepared who are like, I don't need all this practice, right? I just want to take that exam. So interesting learnings there as well for future models, and maybe this isn't for everybody. So these are things we're learning. If I had 8 hours, I could tell you more. But this is just a snippet of our experience, and I hope that it informs you as you go forward sort of brainstorming about what CBE is for Penn State, what problems it can solve, and what sort of intervention services and work it's going to take to get those programs up and going.
Terrific, Marni. Thank you so much. Thank you, Marni. So we're going to transition now to our panel. And so I'm going to ask Rob and Kyle Peck and Marni to, and Marni, I have a cup of coffee coming for you in just 1 second. So this is, to me, is just really kind of fascinating, a little scary, a little overwhelming. I'm thinking of all of the transitions we're going through as an institution as well, trying to get our heads around this. And Marni, I think one of the questions, I posted a question to Rob and Kyle here that I'm going to ask them in a moment to respond to. And that is, in Penn State's system, what problems might we see CB as a potential answer for? So that's where I want to come to them first with that. But Marni, as you migrate to the front, I'm going to ask you as well, and maybe I'll start with you here. How do you have any suggestions of how we might think about what problem we want to address? What have you seen in these other programs that you've worked with? How did they get their heads around one thing?
So we wanted to look at problems that needed to be solved in areas where there would be the least resistance. So we were looking for certain majors with very large audiences of students and unmet demand where we were not performing as well as we could, or we were looking at certain populations. There's a giant degree completion market, for example, in Texas that we do not serve as well as we should. And so degree completion became a target. Student populations coming out of the military who come in with a lot of significant and well-assessed prior learning experience became another student population. So we kind of looked for the intersection between significant problem that we could measure the impact of what we were doing within for a population of students or in a domain of education where there would be a good uptake of the project where we would experience the least resistance. We didn't want to go in fighting somebody to try to do this, and we wanted them to pull us in, not us to push in.
So as we said before, Penn State is just trying to explore this domain and kind of get our heads around what CBE might mean to us. And I'm curious, maybe from your first thoughts here, gather a question or two. These were the comments that came up from the Prime the Pump this morning. We had issues about credit hour. I recognize PLA was in her talk. The whole issue about the administrative services of the university needing to adjust and to accommodate to a different environment. We have both faculty and student workload issues over here. So the impression I take away from your talk this morning, Marni, was that this is a large endeavor, and it will require some different kind of systematic thinking for us. So. Let me start with you, Kyle, and then I'm going to go to Rob. So the question I asked both Kyle and Rob to think about was, what problem, is there one that we might think of at Penn State as a potential for a CB as an option? So if I could start with you, Kyle.
The answer is yes.
Terrific. Thank you. Rob? No. Kyle's never a one-word answer. We know that. So
For me, they say to a man with a hammer, every problem looks like a nail. To me, there are lots of good options. But the one I'm most passionate about is the creation of competency-based learning designers. So we have many designers in this room. One of the secrets to Penn State's success in world campuses, high-quality instructional design. I would like to see us do a competency-based program that trains designers. When you talk about the problem, as Marni mentioned, competency-based education is taking off. Not here yet, but other places. It went from the first year the U.S. Department of Ed invited applications, there were two applicants. It went to 10, it went to 50, it went to 250, it's over 600 now universities that are moving in this direction. It takes serious instructional design, and we need to prepare people for that. I like the competency-based education trajectories that would prepare people for that role. It can be a trajectory into the workplace. It can also be a bachelor's degree, the core of a bachelor's degree. It can be a trajectory into our master's programs and doctoral programs. And to me, that's where I'd like to see. And I, by the way, I'd like to enlist the instructional designers in the room and beyond in the development of that. Just as many authors will come together to write a book, I'd like to see our designers take different pieces of that and put it together, perhaps sharing royalties as they would for a textbook, or sharing revenues that have come back from World Campus or so on. So to me, that's one. We have the other common problems of courses, killer courses, in many different fields, where people start in STEM professions and they wash out. And they wash out because it's not an opportunity to take as much time as you need to get there. It's a sorting process. So I think there are numerous, and my passion is do it in my own field.
Great. Rob, can we go to you?
Yeah.
Oh.
So maybe I'm going to take that question to a little bit loftier level and talk, at least initially, not just about the problem we can solve at Penn State, but what the problem we can solve in higher education. And you know, I think what it will help us do is find a better balance between what the public and employers and the rest of society would like us to do and what we're doing, you know, what we can provide. And so, you know, people express the value of education in a lot of different ways. And, you know, employers will talk about whether we're actually preparing students for the competencies they need. And they often see a gap between what we provide and what they want. And the public wants to see us provide students with an education that will allow them to earn money, to have, you know, lucrative careers. You know, sometimes there's a misfit between those two things. But there was actually a really interesting article in the Chronicle earlier this week about the success of Stanford in producing students who could start startups, something like 6,000 active startups that students you know, have produced. And what was interesting was that their response to that was that they managed to balance the kind of technical skills with the liberal arts education and the kinds of, you know, kind of foundation that provides. And the fact that that really helped in terms of their interactions with industry and determining really what, you know, what those competencies were that industry wanted. And the idea that those two things go together in producing students who are good problem solvers and who understand the interdisciplinary thing, you know, kind of nature of the world and the fact that breakthroughs happen at those boundaries. So, you know, they're not looking just at the competencies, but at that broader perspective of problem solving and critical thinking. So then bringing it down to the Penn State level, I guess, what I would say is that we have very significant variation in the students that come to our doors. And, you know, the traditional way of dealing with that, and that gets a little bit to what Kyle was saying about the difficulty of courses and so on, is that students are starting in different places. The traditional way to handle that is through kind of developmental courses. And unfortunately, that slows things down. Students take longer. It costs them more money. And so if we can find ways to kind of move them into the curriculum more quickly, personalize it, make it more of a kind of a mainstreaming instead of having courses of a full semester duration that they have to get through before they get to the real college stuff, that will be a huge issue. So if competency-based approach, a personalized pacing, and a personalized content can help us do that, that would be a tremendous advantage.
So you could see individual courses having this approach. You could see trajectories of courses, or for certain students to solve certain problems, entire degrees. And each one of those decisions or each one of those solutions is going to have an impact on how you define competency, what that learning experience and that teaching experience is going to be like, and to the extent to which it does or does not have a massive impact on associated support services and academic operations and technologies.
Yeah, I had a question for Marni. I noticed of the programs you had up there at the UT system, that seems like most of them have accredited programs and have established outcomes. And so I'm guessing that was not a coincidence. And did that go toward picking programs that maybe had a lower bar?
Yeah, yes. So the criteria that we sort of had in place, those criteria was, we were looking for programs where their accreditation, by the nature of their accreditation, they were also already used to talking about performance outcomes or competencies or whatever they call them. That was critical for us. We didn't want to have to fight that mindset going in, along with high employer demand. And we went out and talked to industry across the state and across the country. What are you looking for? And then high student demand. So that was kind of the, we were looking to go through the intersection of those three things with these first projects.
Thank you. Hi. I've been using a mastery learning model in my online course for about 8 years to very positive effect. And you'd mentioned mastery learning as in a list of other things that you were saying. So how do you, how does anybody see transitioning mastery learning into a CBE model, or is it more or less the same thing? Is there something else that has to happen other than administratively?
So again, it's all part of the model. So I would say, depending on who you are and when you went to ed school and what you call things, ours is at this BS in Biomedical Sciences is sort of at the intersection of competency-based learning, mastery-based learning, performance-based assessment, right? And with a high degree of concern for the forgetting curve. So it's a very incremental, spiraled curriculum that keeps coming back and back and back to core concepts, practice, sort of experiment, fail, learn, repeat, experiment, fail, learn, repeat at a higher and higher level of sort of complexity. So you could call that program, depending on your definition of mastery-based learning, a mastery approach or a performance approach. There are other competency-based programs that are exactly traditional programs. It's just when you take that exam or assessment, instead of getting a credit, you get a competency, or you get a subcompetency. So it kind of depends on the model. Pedagogical approach I see as very, it's almost a different question. We're going to do CBE with a project-based, problem-driven pedagogical approach in this modality of delivery, right? They aren't mutually exclusive. One does not imply the other.
Well, then let me follow up with a question administratively because of the perceived roadblocks that you brought up. I think at Penn State, we still have the ability to do portfolio-based, credit by portfolio and credit by examination. So is it possible to force fit sort of you've finished a certain series of competencies and then turn that into, administratively turn that into a credit by examination or a credit by portfolio? I guess
is
maybe
that portfolio at the program level or at the course level?
At the course level.
Well, so if you could take that portfolio capability and extend it across courses, then it would be helpful. But the course, term and course are the problem, right?
Mm-hmm,
They're the
right.
villains. If we're just doing CBE within a course, no problem, right? Portfolio is great for that. But if it's a trajectory of courses, so instead of forcing students to take pre-calc and then calc and then whatever the calc two, and that's 15 weeks, we say, you need to have that trajectory complete and all of those competencies and credits earned before you can gate into this next set of courses. And we're not going to worry about term length or even course. We're going to give you trajectories of assessments where you gain points toward basically accomplishments that allow you to get equivalency credits. That's where things go south in our current system because a course, by definition, sort of generally speaking, is for period of time, which is a term, which is connected to your registration and enrollment, which is connected to your financial aid, which is also connected to faculty workload. It's when you try to blow that up that then things get interesting, and innovation can happen if you got the right team together to solve for those problems. And it also presses technology also, because if you think of like, any LMS is course-based and associated with a course-based gradebook. If you want to blow that up, it becomes very tricky. You can do it inside of an LMS, but it takes a lot of tricky kind of maneuvering, and in the end, it's very constraining.
If I can just add a note or two to that, Steve. I've looked at the credit by exam and credit by portfolio policies there. My first surprise was that's undergraduate only, and that we don't have policies like that that apply to graduate school, which was a problem the way I see it for a lot of us. So there is that, and the answer should be yes, that if you create a series of competencies with good measurements, you should be able to use those as credit by exam or credit by portfolio, fitting the existing policy, and not necessarily worrying about semester, right? Because my understanding is that when they pass those, they pay a fee, there's paperwork that's done, and it appears on a transcript. One of the reasons I was told we don't have those policies at the graduate level, and one of the students we were working for to get a credit by portfolio option executed was actually a Ph.D. student. I was told by the grad school that's already the Ph.D., we don't count hours, so you don't need to get those credits because the Ph.D. is a competency-based degree, I was told. And when you think about it, yeah, they have to pass comprehensive exams. They have to do the dissertation with the committee. So Ph.D. is kind of, we can kind of already envision that, but it doesn't meet the other. I see there's really two aspects to that definition. The time one, time varies versus content varies, one that Marni displayed really well. And then there's that the outputs are measured and quantified and related to what people need to do in the real world. So we have that one, it solves that one problem, but then the time-based thing. So your mastery learning probably isn't going to be called competency-based learning because it doesn't meet that flexible time criteria. But again, as we get creative and say, if it's about letting students move at an appropriate pace, giving them credit for things they already know, reducing time to degree completion, and as Rob said, maximizing the sort of the congruence between what we're producing and what employers are looking for without sacrificing. I really like the way you said, strike that balance between what employers are looking for and what we, who we are and what we believe is important. So, yeah, so we're close, but I think we might need to investigate some of those policies at the graduate level for degrees other than the Ph.D.
Rob, any response to that? Anything to add?
I think the portfolio assessment and credit by portfolio programs we have allow a lot of flexibility in how we manage this. And I think it's all in the mechanics. I think we do have the flexibility to offer students part credit for various courses and then accumulate that over the various experiences they've had. The difficulty is that the courses have a beginning and end and a certain amount of content between those two points. And so how do you address that kind of accumulation within that kind of limiting structure?
In my role as an academic advisor, I work directly with students, and we have high-achieving students who have mastered the system of our current K-12 higher ed system. They're high achievers. They know how to study for the test. Their teachers have taught them how to study to the test, and they've mastered how to be a good student. So how do you see us combating or getting them to get that buy-in, as you mentioned earlier, for those high-achieving students who just wanted to take the test, get over with the course, and keep moving forward?
So, can you hear me? Is my mic on? Yeah. In a true competency-based program that allows for personalization of pace, completely personalization of pace, which our UTRGV example is not a super great example of, because they're, but if you let them go forward, those students could just take that assessment, whatever it is, whether it is a gate into a project that they have to do or gate into a paper that they have to write, they could take it, they could write that paper or do that project, and they'd be done. They'd finish the course in 5 weeks instead of 15 weeks. So in a true competency-based format, you know, it speaks to both ends of that range. Because the student who comes in who needs more just-in-time development, they can slow down. Those other students can speed up. And that's from a student's perspective. That value proposition is pretty easy to sell. When we were down at UTRGV and we talked about that in the courses where that's true, like chemistry, students got very excited about that. That's a challenge for them, and it's also a relief for them. And so that's the way that would work. And then, of course, getting faculty to believe in that value proposition is the other thing, because it sounds good on paper, but when the rubber meets the road, somebody mentioned it here, faculty who grew up in a system where everybody needs to keep the same pace and take the same exams or do the same projects at the same time, this is as much a hazing process as it is anything else to prove that you've got what it takes. Start getting really nervous when they see students having to take a long time to get to goal, but getting to goal. Because is that fair? Is that right? Are they really at the same goal if one student took 15 minutes and the other one took 5 weeks? It's kind of interesting how it works on the mindset of folks who did not themselves grow up in this learning system.
And Lindsay, I just want to add a note to that. If you have really good assessments and you capture the evidence. So right now, people are skeptical and they don't trust that students learn things, and they say they graduate without the ability to do important things and so on. But if somebody is a high achiever and wants to move through something and you have an assessment that captures the essence of what it means to perform at that level, and when they submit that, they submit it electronically and it gets stored as part of the submission, and the rubric that you use to assess that is also public, and you know the feedback from the reviewers can be made public, all that can be part of you know, what you call a digital badge or micro certification. And then I think somebody challenges and says, wait a minute, this person got through here, and we say, yeah, would you like to see their work? Mm-hmm. You know, we've defined it well, we documented it, it's stored. You know, if you have questions, you know, bring it. And by the way, I'd like to see your students' work that you're saying, you know, took 15 weeks and went through a program where your learning outcomes were not well defined.
We have if I can sort of stay in this thread for a moment, we have a couple online questions that I think relate to this space. Marni, for you, is the Rio Grande Valley program have an impact on pre-med students? Does the CBE model have an impact on pre-med students? And did the whole program go to CBE?
So we hope that it will have an impact on pre-med or pre-PA or wherever they're going to graduate school. We've just started it, so we will see.
Okay.
And we're just in the middle of the first term, so we will see. It appears like a fairly positive story in terms if you look at their performance against historical data, but that's hard to do because we have such richness in the data that we're collecting about their performance against midterm and final exams from previous years. So it's almost like comparing apples and oranges. So we shall see. That's the aim and beyond. That not only getting medical performance on MCAT, getting into medical school, performance in residencies and beyond is what we're interested in. And I can't remember the second question.
Okay. Did the whole program go to a CBE model?
The whole program did go to a CBE model. So early on, we realized that some of the real barriers for student success and performance on MCAT and getting into medical school were not, those barriers and those challenges were not just coming from the biomedical sequence, but they were coming from the basic sciences. And they were coming from an attitude and mindset among students that some of their general core courses that they had to take were not important because they weren't tested on the MCAT. So that was affecting performance across all of the courses. We decided early on that we would create a version of the program, all 120 credits. That is a pathway that you as a student can choose to take or not. But if you want to take that pathway, it's set up for you so that all of those programs are through the lens of biomedicine, science, and technology, and they are sort of connected to this red thread of this clinical or community-based experience. And when we designed those, we actually could design across the stack of a given term. We can control for the stack, cognitive stack of a given term. We could actually make sure that if students follow a particular pathway, that those but also that they're designed in such a way that the assignments reinforce each other from the different areas. So what you're doing in comp is actually preparing you as you're thinking and writing about your own experience of pain and illness, is preparing you to do better and engage more deeply with some of the other areas of learning. Some students and their parents are super excited about that map, because the map is the success problem for many of these students. They don't know what the map is. They don't choose the right courses. They choose toxic combinations of courses. So it was trying to solve for that problem. Other students want nothing to do with that map because they're exploring different things. And that's okay.
So I'm going to ask a follow-up to that. So on the transcript, so they don't take Composition 10X, right? They take they're in these modules that miss, but their transcript's going to say Composition 10X.
Yeah.
So I just want people to understand what's happening in this program and some others is that they're doing a multidisciplinary approach that takes the learning outcomes from their composition courses and their gen eds and mixes it with their content area specialization. They're rolling that into experiences. And on the transcript, it's going to say, because they took the outcomes and they sort of built that all into the program over the course of the experience, and in the end they're going to have a transcript that looks like they took individual courses, which I think is interesting and
difficult.
Well, that's that map that I showed you. Mm-hmm. That's why that map is necessary for this program, because all those assessment activities or learning experiences, as we call them, which are assessment activities, everything is an assessment activity, are tied back to the requirements for the composition for General Chemistry 1 or General Chemistry 1 Lab or Biomed. It's extremely complicated work. And we still have them in clusters. They're the orange, green, and blue clusters, so it wasn't completely blown apart.
Mm-hmm.
But it's very complicated and interesting work to do that knowledge and assessment mapping, and then to have confidence to create an equivalency with one of those courses, which we had to do because students will not get into medical school unless they have Gen Chem 1 and 2, O Chem 1 and 2, physics, calculus, biology on their transcript.
This next question is an online one, Rob, and it's directed to you. Peter Butler is asking if the CVE model is a prescribed kind of path that students move through, do we lose the potential for, the socialization aspect of learners in their higher education experience? Make sure I'm getting that right. I'm wondering what might be lost in CBE, but what might be gained if we convert courses to that type of a model? So he's asking about socialization, the other kinds of things I think that you, the spontaneity of your college experience, does that change or does that potentially change in this kind of a model?
Yeah, I'm not sure what he means by socialization, but if he means interactions with fellow students, with faculty, I mean, obviously, and I think this is one of the concerns that's been raised in some of the audits of CBE is that there needs to be evidence of that regular and substantive interaction with the peers and with faculty. So if that's what he means by socialization and the advantage and importance of that kind of interaction as a student accumulates knowledge and synthesizes it, then I think that is of concern.
Okay, thank you. Kyle?
As Marni pointed out, that's not necessarily a problem with CBE. It's a problem with certain implementations of CBE. And you, if that's a concern, and it should be, then you design for that.
Yeah, okay, good. Thank you. Jerry's got a question?
Yeah, how much time did and effort did the development of that map take?
Well, it is an extraordinary amount of time and effort, and it's not done because it's a, can you hear me? It's a, sorry, I've become paranoid. It's a, it's that map starts out as a hypothesis, right? And there are lots of players, whether it's Newton or Lucien or others or Pearson who are claiming to have new technologies and methodologies for coming up with those knowledge graphs, but essentially most of it is, let's take all the textbooks on that topic, let's crunch them into a software that will spit them back out as a taxonomy, and then you humans can go and readjust the connections between things to create the map of the world as you see it. And it's not just one map, it's all the different maps from all the disciplinary areas that then connect together, which when you're doing that basically explodes the disciplinary areas. And then so it's very, very complex, and you start with a hypothesis that you can handle in the time that you have. And all the data that you're collecting about how students traverse that map through looking at your content analytics and the choices they make there, how much time they spend on that content, looking at the analytics on the different types of activities that you're doing and how well they perform there and engage there, looking at your social analytics and seeing what they're actually talking about and discussing, your intervention analytics, thinking about what are the questions are they asking their instructional facilitators or their student life coach, and you start getting a sense of the validity, the reliability and validity of the math that you started out with. And that is something where we've just taken the first step. And it will take years and years, I think, to get robust maps that we can all look at it and say, yeah, that's not a map of the world from 1400, that's a map of the world from 2015.
Well, sure. So clearly it's a work in progress, and yeah, it always will be.
Yeah.
But I think that if I were going to set up something, my first question would be, how much time am I going to need before I can pull the trigger, before I can start?
So
a year, 2 years,
so
6 months?
So in our methodology, so we have an emergent but tested over across of multiple use cases now methodology for program concepting, which is where the map begins. And then coming up with the competency scaffold and the knowledge map blueprint, and then based on that, coming up with the learning experiences, the assessment trajectories, and then coming up with the content, curating the content or creating the content against those trajectories. The program concepting is a 15-week process. The competence scaffold and an initial blueprint, which evolves, is a 15-week process. And then the work thereafter is implied by the scope of what we're taking on, right? So depending on how much, what kind of a map, what kind of blueprint we're creating, and the scope of that blueprint, it will take a longer or shorter time to see that out in terms of building those assessments, curating that content, or developing the content that we're doing. And so what we've been trying to get to is a methodology for doing that, because any instructional designer will tell you, you know, even just to develop a simple course or online course with the faculty, it's sometimes you're wrangling individual faculty in, and they've got other things they're doing with their time, and you know, it's hard to get it done under a promise of 15 weeks. So that's why we've been so stressing this methodology that we use and the team that we bring in around that methodology. So when we do concepting and blueprinting, it's not just faculty, it's faculty, it's instructional designers, it's a team of subject matter experts in that field who have very targeted knowledge, it's people who are experts in taxonomy and content curation. It's an army of soldiers with different types of expertises that are following a very distinct methodology for getting there. And the way that we work it is we have these almost day-long workshops with the faculty,
where we work with them on that benchmark at hand, get all their ideas, get all their hopes, fears, anxieties out on the table, get all their kind of own blueprints out on the table. This team takes that work. We create the next benchmark with it. We bring that benchmark back. We review as a team. We refine, and the process starts again. So we don't expect faculty to go off in between these workshops and come up with these maps alone in a silo. I've actually tried to do that one time when I was at Columbia, and it drove the faculty members stark raving mad. It was like writing a textbook on steroids. It's very hard. So it really is a team-based approach. And the composition of that team, back to the idea that Kyle has, and the skill sets they bring to the fold are critical in whether or not it's going to be successful.
Yeah, I have a question about from kind of the University of Texas, the system level. You know, you set up a separate kind of parallel learning structure, essentially, with this competency-based programs that you're building. I'm just kind of wondering, you've firewalled things off so you can kind of build and innovate without having some of the barriers you have in traditional organizational structures and things like that, and resistance. What are you doing in terms of curricular alignment with existing programs the engagement of faculty within those programs?
That's part of the, so in parallel to this curriculum and blueprinting and knowledge mapping and design, there's a blueprint for every touch point of this program with every sort of incumbent service, right? So there needs to be a new blueprint for how we do everything from prospect management to app to admissions to enrollment to re-enrollment, and how we interact with those services for traditional programs. There has to be a blueprint for academic operations and advising. There has to be a blueprint for technology support and associated services specific to the program. So the blueprinting that goes on, we've been focusing on the curriculum. Everybody always focuses on the curriculum, but it's these other services that really also have to be choreographed and orchestrated so they work well too. And if there's a touch point back to the island, that has to be identified. And wherever that's touching, we need to have a relationship with those folks and those services so that they understand as well as we do, or almost as well, what's going on. So there's more to blueprinting than just the academic curricular blueprint. Did I answer your question?
Right, and you can add to that, and I know this well since these are folks I deal with every day, is registrar, the student aid, student information system, most of you know, we're implementing a new system. You know, it's very sophisticated, it's got a lot of capabilities, but in many ways it's reduced flexibility because it's a vendor-based system that we don't want to customize because that's a costly proposition as upgrades and so on occur. So, you know, there's a lot of things we have to think about in advance and start working on in order to make this work. There's infrastructure out there that has to accommodate the kind of a new concept for pacing and content and, you know, you name it.
It was pretty much answered. I was concerned about, my question was, how did the University of Texas system make sure that students get those kind of soft skill competencies as well, like group work and communication with other students and those sorts of things, if they're allowed to kind of zoom through things? There seems to be like a missing personal component, and again, the socialization and that sort of thing that everybody kind of needs. Once we get out in the world, we need to be able to work with other people. So group work is always a big thing in undergraduate education, for instance. And so how were those things looked at, or, you know, did you decide that they weren't, that wasn't the place for them to learn those, or how did you handle that?
So at UTRGV, it's a hybrid program. It's a face-to-face program with a flipped classroom approach. So they're in class for each of these
trajectories, orange, green, and blue, every week. They're in class with their faculty for 2 hours in a two-hour block, in a classroom that's designed to support the team-based learning activities. And they are in class with their instructional facilitators, who are like disciplinary TAs. They're not associated with a course. They're associated with the whole first year. For 2 hours for differentiated approach to group work. And so the challenge in a flipped classroom environment where you allow for a personalization of pace is different in a totally online environment. So in the social challenge for us in this face-to-face program is, okay, they're going to come in and we're going to use the performance or the team-based learning frameworks as the way to differentiate instruction in the faculty-led session. So no matter where they are in this personalized trajectory, when they come into class, we're going to build an experience that is accessible no matter where you are in the range, and that is problem-driven and that links to these 17 diseases and conditions, these clinical reasons. So that was not an easy design challenge right there. And then in the instructional facilitators sessions, the coach study hours, we had to work on a classroom management approach where they're breaking these students into groups based on data that they're getting just in time before the class, and working with them in those groups through peer learning, et cetera, to help them solve for the problems that they're having that week. So pedagogically, we used two different differentiated strategies in that flipped classroom environment. Both of those strategies have struggled in the first 8 weeks of the program because they're hard. And also, once faculty started seeing, so this was really interesting. We all know if you've taught a big lecture course, you all know that on Tuesday at 4 p.m., not everybody is at the same place. Many students, unfortunately, like myself when I was an undergraduate, are waiting till the week before the midterm to study that stuff. And they're going to just let it slide for a week. But you can't see it when you're looking out at a big classroom like that. You can't see it. You don't have windows into it. As soon as you can see it, oh my God, only 20% of my students have gotten through the readings and the concepts that are critical for their understanding of what I'm going to talk about this week or what I'm going to do this week. All of a sudden, the faculty response was, I need to catch them up in this two-hour period. Instead of doing this team-based learning framework, I'm going to give them a lecture that's going to miraculously catch them up to where they should be conceptually. And I'm going to give them that team-based learning for homework. This is exactly what happened. Or in the case of the instructional facilitators, it takes a while to get really good at that initiated peer learning strategy. So these are the struggles of the flipped classroom environment of CBE. On the online side, in a massive program like nursing is likely to be, they have 12,000 enrollments in their current program online. The question becomes, we have project-based learning, case-based, collaborative case-based learning, team-based learning, and clinicals that are part of their online pedagogy. So the problem becomes, and this has nothing to do with CBE, this has to do with personalization of pace. If we're going to gate students into those experiences from a logistical point of view, are we going to have enough students at any given time who are at that benchmark, that gateway, so that we have a cohort large enough for them to work on these? And what kind of sorting hat mechanism are we going to use to identify that they're at that place and put them on teams or whatever? So they're... And how long do they have to wait? I mean... Yeah, like you will, your team, it's November 1st, your team will start working on January 1st. Logistically, unless you have a lot of students going through this, that can be very difficult. So there are all kinds of problems to solve along the way. None of them are unsolvable. I don't sit here today to make it seem like, oh, it's just that you have to think about them. Each context sort of provides a new set of problems and challenges that have to be addressed.
Some of my best faculty, best instructors, are tenured faculty. And they like to compartmentalize their teaching. They're great at it, but they want to compartmentalize. And it seems that personalized pace kind of explodes that. And it makes it very difficult to compartmentalize. So instructors give exams on the same day because it makes it easier for them. It minimizes the amount of cross-communication between students and so on. Could you speak to the experience either at RGV or at Columbia that you've had with tenured faculty doing this?
So, sometimes when I get really down about all of this, I think about exactly this problem because it's a big challenge, right? You've got these amazing faculty who are not only good teachers in some cases, but they are also extreme subject matter experts. They're exactly the kind of people that you want to have working on the knowledge map, and you want to have working on the pedagogy, and you want to have working on the kind of system design. They're the partners that you want to have. But there's nothing in the current system that incents them to participate in this. What's the incentive? What's the incentive? Blow up your curriculum. Blow up your compartmentalization of the task so that you can do your research, so that you can do your writing. And so the lack of an incentive system is a big barrier for tenure faculty, but also more junior faculty who are working on getting to that tenure. They even, in a way, have less incentive to do this work because it's going to interfere and get in the way of the goal. So part of, I think, the trick for the future of education, which isn't going to be simple and isn't going to happen overnight, is if we're going to do this, whether and on an experimental site or in the mainstream, what are the incentives for faculty to get involved? And what I've seen in my experience at Columbia and at Penn and at MD Anderson and at UTRGV, all very different institutions, but where we've faced the same problem every time, is that each of those institutions has come up with an incentive strategy that works and is organic for their mission. But it's hard. It's really hard. And what we've, as I've been talking to folks out in the world of CBE, or just in the world of innovation, forget CBE, just in the world of future models of education where faculty are being asked to blow up practice and to come up with new ideas and to change everything. There are some schools out there who are starting to come up with ways to credit faculty for this experience like you would credit them for anything else, whether it's research or publications or et cetera. And so some interesting frameworks are sort of jumping up on that front. But it's hard, and it's a really good question, part of why these kind of transformative changes are really difficult. They have a hard time taking hold.
In the beginning years here, we had some resistance to learning. Eventually that sort of overcame in the university. Now I think in many aspects it's accepted and understood as a method for some applications. What are the cultural issues here? Maybe, Rob, I could start with you, if you wouldn't mind, at Penn State around CBE. How do we?
I think it's difficult. Looking at faculty, for instance, it's in their DNA to be the sage. They don't want to be the guide. They want to be the sage. And so they want to maximize their opportunity to be in front of the students, front and center. I'll just go back a little bit to my own experience, and I was interested in the title of the Chronicle article today. It talked about that we're reverting back to something that was popular 40 years ago, and now it's the big idea in higher education. 40 years ago, I was a graduate assistant teaching in a self-paced program for the three courses that serve as the weed-out system for engineering students, the engineering mechanics sequence. It was known as the Keller Plan. It was taught in universities across the country, including Penn State. And it basically involves students working at their own pace through a series of modules. I think there were 25 or 30 that they needed to complete over the course of the semester if they wanted to earn an A. And so it was kind of a variant on contract grading. If you did them all, You did the problem solving that led up to taking a quiz. You passed the quiz. You moved on to the next module. If you completed them all, you got an A. If you completed some subset, you got a B, and so on. So it wasn't really a personalized learning process because everybody worked through the same modules. And the outcome was variable learning, so because some of the students completed them all and some didn't. So it didn't have all the current attributes of competency-based learning, which is supposed to end up with everybody achieving the same mastery, right? Even if it's not in the same time. We loved it as graduate assistants working with the students. We loved it. We could see the students' progress. The interaction was, I think, very good for students. Students who could move quickly were not bored as they might be in a traditional classroom setting. Those who needed a slower pace weren't frustrated by always being behind. So there were great aspects to it. Faculty hated it. That's why it disappeared, because it really didn't fit the model of what faculty thought they were buying into when they came into academia. So it's a huge it's a huge question as to how we as was mentioned, incent faculty and have them kind of try and change their mindset of where their role is and how they can achieve the things that interested them about teaching in the first place.
Kyle, can I go to you, and then I'm going to end with Marni?
Yeah, so I think the teaching role is changing. I agree. There is a lot to be said for being the sage on the stage. That's rewarding. I remember, this is old Bill Cosby, there was a commercial trying to recruit teachers a long time ago who said, come into education. This time, the big desk will be yours. You want that power, you want that position, and performing and telling a joke and having people laugh and all that is really part of a great lifestyle. But I think that we need to understand that with that great lifestyle comes a lot of inefficiency and that life is changing. And people now can buy what they want online, have it personalized, sent to them in 2 days, and they have better information about what they're buying. They get to leave comments, they get to read other people's comments, and that just because it works for us doesn't mean that it works for learners and employers and the rest of the world. And that, I believe it's inevitable these changes will take place, and that faculty members, be they, and this will take place over the next decade and a half, and different kinds of people will work. I see a comprehensive university being one that not only covers all the subjects like we do, but covers them in ways that fit the different segments of the population that are out there. So we have a degree program which is for certain people who can come to campus. It's a great lifestyle change. It's history. They find a spouse. It's wonderful, right? And for that, for some people, that's it. But we have lots of other people out there who are career changers or degree completers or retired people who just want to explore music and the arts, and so we have an opportunity here, and the people who are ready to teach that way will find people who want to be taught that way, and people like Richard Branson will hire people like Marni and her crew to create an alternate. And so I think this one size fits all, one model is going to shake loose in the next 15 years, and there will be places for people who are comfortable on stage to stay on stage for a while, and there will be other places where people who are ready for these innovative models to go that way too.
Good, thank you, Marni. To the question of cultural change, what any advice, insights?
Well, so my experience, which is not maybe irrelevant, but I will just share it, is that the best trigger for mindset shift is a prototype that is out there functioning and that can become a sandbox for faculty to really look at and see. Because a lot of times it sounds a lot scarier and like a lot more work than it is until they can see, see what's positive about it. It's just like the iPhone or the iPad. Before before we got one, if somebody had explained it to us, would we have won and went, eh? But once we saw it, it totally changed the mindset very, very quickly. So I think prototypes and experimental sites where you control as many of the variables as you can, where you see them as engines for researching and improving the model, and where you invent and you invite a wider and wider community of practice and learning in to see what's going on, are the gunnar barks that lead us to whatever the future is. And so that's what I think works. I've seen it work in the Ivy League. I've seen it work in extreme professional school cases, and I've seen it work now in the Rio Grande Valley as the spark that, who knows, 10 years from now, 20 years from now, 50 years from now, might lead to changes that we can't even imagine or architect in the current state.
Terrific, thank you. Please join me in thanking our panel this afternoon.